right? This is the observer zenith is up here, right? This is the zenith from the GP to the star. You just have an obtuse angle and you correct it down. That's all you do. This dip thing is a load of nonsense. To do height of void on the globe, you can't. Well, you can't get an angle off that surface and you can't do height of void correction because you bring down your height of void and the horizon, which is out here, right, for the person, is lower than the water underneath the boat. Here we have, similar to what it shows in those diagrams, here we have, this, they say this is the observer. This is sea level below them, right? This is their dip to the supposed geometric horizon, right? Or sorry, refracted horizon, right? We're told we'll never see the geometry of the globe. This fourth circle here, that is a 3959 radius. The second one, right, which is kind of orange, that is the 7/6, right? The next one is 8, with the red is 8/6, right? Or the next one is 9/6, which is the green circle. And the last one then is, I put in, is 10/6. That means that their refracted globe, because it's a consistently refracted, that's their claim, right? That's going to be changing all the time, up and down. An accordion horizon going on, right? Their globe is going up and down, up and down. The point is that with their moving horizon, it would be impossible to ever have consistency. You'd never have any measurements correct. So when you're making your three circles of equal latitude, which can't go onto a globe because they're not circles, the point is that none of it can happen because it's all going to be wildly out. None of it would work.
That was a taster from some recent Brian's Logic videos, where he's been trying to explain dip angle correction with all kinds of outlandish theories and wacky drawings. So in this video, I thought I'd try and clear up some of his confusion by exploring that geometry for myself. But before looking at dip angles, let me take a moment to try and explain why globe geometry is generally depicted with straight lines of sight, instead of curved light rays like this one, which I've exaggerated quite a bit. Now, the Earth and the ray each have their own radius values, and if I want to straighten out the light ray, then I have to increase its radius. But in doing so, I also have to increase the Earth's radius to maintain the balance in the geometry. Once we're dealing with straight lines, the line of sight to the horizon for this observer is simply drawn with a tangent. And there's a few ways of showing the dip angle. And as you can see, these remain equal when altering the observer's height. Introducing the line to the star gives us these two angles. And I should say that this line is actually curved and as such subject to correction, but for this video, I'm just going to keep it straight. If we can measure this co-altitude angle directly, then there's no need for a sextant because the co-altitude is ultimately the angle that we're wanting to acquire. And as starlight arrives in the region around Earth in a parallel fashion, altering the observer's height will not alter the co-altitude angle, but it will affect the angle the sextant measures. Subtracting the dip angle together with any refraction correction to the star gives us the star's true elevation angle. Subtracting that from 90 gives us the co-altitude. Here I've introduced some scales so I can obtain actual values and distances that should agree with Metabunk, the Nautical Almanac, or Walter Bislins' Advanced Curve Calculator. So feel free to pause and check the values at any time. Notice I have a couple of sliders to vary the observer height and the refraction strength. And for the latter, I'm using Brian's N/6R scale. 6/6R means that there's no refraction, and this ramps up to 16/6R, where refraction is considered severe. We'll keep this on no refraction for the moment. Also notice how close the observer is to the surface. and this means that the tangent line to the horizon will also be very close to the surface as a result, and any dip angle will be tiny. Adding the line of sight to the star gives us our two angles. Again, changing the observer height won't change the co-altitude angle at all, only the sextant angle. Here the dip angle is 0.102 degrees, and no matter which star I look at, that's not going to change for this height. And moving from no refraction to 7 over 6R, there isn't a great deal of change. In fact, for an observer at 10 meters high, moving from 6 over 6R, where there's no refraction, all the way over to 16 over 6R, when it's severe, only amounts to about 0.04 degrees difference in dip angle. And that's about 2.5 minutes, which means errors due to day-to-day irregularities can be pretty trivial to casual navigators in the grand scheme of things.
But which is, they're trying to say this is happening, but it's not. Within their own model, that's what would happen. Right now, that's not a height of void correction, but that's what they try and claim it is. It's not a height of void correction, it's not a dip correction. But it doesn't matter because it's still an obtuse angle, still wrong, right? So no matter what way you twist or turn it, none of it works on a globe. This doesn't work. On a globe, you don't have your 90, right? The only way to have the 90 would be if you have a horizontal plane and you correct down. There's your 90. See? Look. 94, 90. Oh, right? 90. Not 90, 90. Not 90, 90. Not 90, 90. That's the only way it can be done.
And that'll do for this video. Let me know in the comment section if you think this will make any difference to Brian's arguments. Either way, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you later.